Welcome to the first section of 5th unit of Molecular Biology paper, and the first section topic is genetic codes. Genetic code is nothing but a triplet code which codes for a particular amino acid in the protein sequence. So genetic code is nothing but a triplet of nucleotide present in the mRNA which codes for a particular amino acid in the protein is known as the genetic code. This genetic code usually present in the mRNA. These genetic codes are recognized by the tRNA molecule which will contain the anticodon arm. The anticodon arm of the tRNA molecule recognizes the codon of the mRNA molecule. That's why the tRNA molecule sometimes called as an adapter molecule, because it is going to adapt a particular codon in the mRNA. This genetic code will have about 7 important features. One is known as genetic code is a triplet. It is non-overlapping. It is continuous. It is highly degenerate. It has sense and nonsense codons. It is almost universal. And the direction of reading is finalized. So that is only one direction the reading is possible. That is only a 5' to 3' end direction of reading occurs. So these are the 7 important features of genetic codes. If you want to say a genetic code, then the genetic code should have all these 7 features. We will see that whether all the features are justified in the case of genetic code. So first feature is known as the genetic code is a triplet. Many people raised question, why the genetic code is triplet? Why can't it be a 4 nucleotide? Or why it is not the 2 nucleotide? Then there is a simple logic formula. That is, we have about 20 basic amino acids. Okay, if you want to code a 20 amino acid with the nucleotide, variety of nucleotide is 4. If you say in mRNA molecule, you have adenosine, guanosine, uracil, and then cytosine. We have only 4 nucleotides in mRNA, but we have 20 amino acids to be coded, to be directed. So if you have only 4 residues, then you can only code for 4 amino acids. So if you have 1 nucleotide, then you will code for only 4 amino acids. So if you have genetic code is a single nucleotide, then it will code only 4 amino acids. If you make the triplet is a 2 bases will be present in a triplet. And what are the possible combination codes power 2? That is 16 combination is possible with 2 nucleotide of this 4 residue. So 4 power 2. But we have 20 amino acids. Still we are lagging 4 amino acids. So we are raising that 2 in one more number. That is 3. So if you put 4 power 3, you will have 4 into 4, 16. 16 into 4, 64. So we have about 64 codons. Now we have about only 20 amino acids. So now there is a possibility for all the 64 codon can code for 64 amino acids. But we have only 20 amino acids, so it is more than enough. Even a single amino acid is coded by more than one codon. That is what the possibility for these 64 codons for this 20 amino acids. That's why minimum genetic code should be a triplet. Then only it codes for the basic 20 amino acid. That is how the genetic code fixed as a triplet. Next characteristic is that genetic code is continuous. It's non-overlapping. Non-overlapping means what? See, the mRNA will contain all the bases. You can see here, this is an mRNA which contains a particular bases. These bases are non-overlapping. That means what? If AUV is present, this will code for only one amino acid. Next, if GCU is present, it codes only for one amino acid. Okay, it is the non-overlapping condition. If it is overlapping means what? AUU codes for one amino acid. Then this UUG. Okay, what is it? UUG will codes for another amino acid. And then this UGC will code for another amino acid. You can see here, AUU codes for AA1 amino acid. And then UUG codes for another amino acid. Then UGC codes for another amino acid. So, these 4-5 bases can code for 3 codons and 3 amino acids. Only 5 bases. A, U, U, G, C. So these 5 bases can code for three amino acids if the genetic code is overlapping. How you can identify whether it's overlapping or not? You just change one base. Say if you change this U. Okay. So if the genetic code is a non-overlapping, then it will affect only a change of one amino acid. If this is a affects three amino acids in the protein, it means that the genetic code is non-overlapping. So they did an experiment. In the experiment, they conclude that the change of one base in one codon will affect only one amino acid. So they concluded that the genetic code is non-overlapping. Okay. If it is overlapping, then when you change a single base in a codon, it might affect three amino acids. It's a substitution. They did a substitution experiment. Not an addition or deletion experiment. They did a substitution experiment. Instead of U, they added one base. So the addition of this base might have changed three amino acids if it is overlapped. But it is affect only one amino acid in nature. So it proves that genetic code is non-overlapping. Then another condition is genetic code is continuous. How you will say that genetic code is continuous? Okay, again you can see that the first line is going to be the genetic code, which will contain three bases. The fat cat ate the big rat. Okay. So, if you delete a C in this third codon, you are really deleting a C. Once you delete it, and then ATA become a codon, then ETH, this C is deleted. So, ATA become one codon, then TET become another codon, HEB become another codon, IGR become another codon, and AT will combine with the other base. Okay, it will form a new codon. If the genetic code is continuous. If the genetic code is separated by any bases or any molecule, then when you remove one particular base from a codon, it won't affect the other codon. If I remove C, then AT remains as such if it is separated by some other bases. Okay, the same thing can be explained with the help of addition. If you add one base, then it will also affect all the other nucleotides. But if you add one base after deletion, then it brings back the original strand. You can see here the cat only changes because you removed the C and now you added one A here. So it affects only this codon. The other codon, D, fat, 8, D, big, rat, remains same. So it shows that the genetic code is a continuous one. If it is separated by any bases, then when you delete a base or insert a base, it will affect only one codon. It won't affect more than one. But in nature, when you delete a base, it affects the whole reading frame of the mRNA molecule. So it shows that the genetic code is continuous. Then the next question, genetic code is highly degenerate. And this is obvious because we have about 64 codons. We have only 20 amino acids to be coded. So we have more than twice. There are about 64. You have only 20. So even a single amino acid might be coded by more than one or two or three codon. So that is how the degenerate is a nature comes into play. When a single codon is coded by more than one amino acid coded by more than one codon is known as degeneracy. So how many codons are available? It is called as its degeneracy. Say for example, alanine, choline, valine, glycine and threonine have 4 codons. That means their degeneracy nature is 4. Whereas serine, leucine will have about 6 triplet. So that is known as their degeneracy is 6-4. Okay. So like that. Even sometimes some codons like initiation codon, AUG, will have only one codon. So they are not having degeneracy. So some amino acid is not at all having degeneracy, but some amino acid will have a degeneracy of 6. Some amino acid will have 3. Some amino acid will have 4. Okay, so this is how the number of degeneracy will vary from one amino acid to the other amino acid. So this is known as genetic code is highly degenerate. Why? Because degenerate? Because we are having the number of codons is greater than the number of amino acids to be coded. So the available amino acid is 20, but we have about 64 codons. So the single amino acid is coded by more than one codon. Then the nature of codon. The codons can be classified into two categories. One is known as a sense codon, the other one is known as a nonsense codon. The sense codons are the codon which codes for an amino acid. The nonsense codons are terminate stopping codons, are known as nonsense codons. They are not going to direct synthesis of any amino acid. But again, I am saying that recently it was proved that the UAG and UGA will code for some amino acid like pyrrolizine and selenocysteine. But previously, both UAG, UGA and UAA, they are collectively called as a nonsense codon. The UAG codon is otherwise called as amber codon. The UAA codon is called as aqua codon. And UGA codon is called as opal codon. So they have other name. These names are utilized for a competitive examination. They will ask, what is an amber codon? What is an aqua codon? What is an opal codon? So you are able to answer this. Similarly, most cases, AUG is considered to be as an initiation codon. Very rarely in organisms, sometimes GUG act as an initiation codon. Then, the genetic code is almost universal. That means what? So, a codon, if I say AUG, almost in most of the prokaryotic organisms, the AUG as well as in eukaryotic organism, more than 90% of microbes as well as the eukaryotic organism, the AUG is the initiation codon. But not in all cases, that's why it is called as almost universal, not all, in few exceptions are present. Then the direction of reading, if we have an mRNA, it will have a 5-2-3 end. Then always you should read from 5- direction to 3- direction. You should not read in a different direction. If you read in a different direction, it will give different protein synthesis. I will explain this with a paint. You can see that. Why the reading direction is very important. As well as we can read it in a 6 frames. A gene can be read it in a 6 frames. You can see now we have a particular a sequence or RNA sequence. I will write now. So the RNA sequence. So this is what you are taking one RNA. Okay. So this RNA sequence is going to present. How we are going to read this RNA? You can read this RNA like AUG. Okay. Then GAU, CAA. So this end is considered to be as a, we can call it as a 5' end. Okay. This end will be a 5' end. And this end will be a, here we will have a 3' end. So you should read this strand from 5' to 3' direction. Clear? So this direction only you should read. So AUG, GAU, CAU. If you read in another direction, say in 3' to 5', then you have a different protein combination you will get. See, CAU and CCU, AAC. So, if you read 3' to 5', you will get different protein sequence. If you read in 5' to 3', you have different protein sequence. So, most of the proteins, say in all the proteins, the reading frame only the 3' to 5' end is correct actually. The other direction is wrong. That is 3' to 5' is wrong, only 5' to 3' direction is correct. Similarly, we have about 6 frames. When you read mRNA, you might read 6 frames of reading is possible. We are saying that how many type of reading is 6 frames. How you will say? So UAA, ACA, UAC, UAA, ACA, AGA, GAA, GAC, GUA, GAC. Okay. So this is about, and then you have about a particular sequence. Okay, so this is normal 5-2-3- direction. If you read the frame, 5-2-3- direction. This is known as frame 1. It is called as frame 1. What is the frame 2? If you copy the same sequence, so if you read by removing the first base, if you remove the first base, okay, what will happen now? How you will read this frame? AAA, okay, then CAU, then ACA, then CAA, then GAG. So you can see that now the frame is changed. AAA is the first frame. Here the UAA is the first frame. So here GAA, then CGU, then AGA. So it's become a frame 2. It is called as frame 2. Then if you remove one more base of this particular sequence, so if again you are taking the own sequence and then you are removing two bases now. We are going to remove, compared to this, two bases. So if you remove two bases, okay, now you think how you will read. So you should read, so like this, AAC. You will read like AAC, then AUA, then CAC, then AAG, then AGA, then AGA, then CGU, then AGA. So this is known as frame 3. So what it means actually, this will code for one amino acid, that is one protein. This will code for another protein with a different amino acid sequence. This will code for another protein with another amino acid sequence. So in 5-3- direction, you might get 3 protein sequences. And you can repeat all these reactions from 3-5- direction also. If you read CAG and GAUG, you will get one particular protein sequence. If you remove the first base, then you will get AGA, UGC, so another second type. Then third, if you remove these two bases, GAU, GCA, so here 3 frames. So in 3-5- direction, if you move, you will get 3 proteins. If you move 5-3- direction, you will get 3 proteins. So totally we have about 6 frames of protein sequence. How many number of protein sequence you might have? You might have 6 type of frames are possible in the case of molecular biology. So for a single mRNA molecule, you might have 6 protein sequence are possible. Okay, but even though 6 possibilities are there, only one possibility is actually produced during the normal translation process. That too, always mRNA is synthesized only from 5-3- direction. Okay, so even though we have about 6 frames, the 6 frames, how they called as 5-3- frame 1, 5-3- frame 2, 5-3- frame 3, then 3-5- frame 1, 3-5- frame 2, 3-5- frame 3. So we have about 6 frames. Even though 6 frames are available, only one frame is going to be read and it is translated into protein. That is what happens in reality. But how many possibilities are there? There are about 6 possibilities are there. Okay, so this is about a vital role when you talk about the direction of reading. Okay, so this codon, from a start codon to a stop codon, that length is known as open reading frame. An mRNA which contains a start codon and it ends in a stop codon. So that frame is known as open reading frame, or it's simply called as a ORF. So there are about 6 reading frames are possible. Out of 6, only one will be available as a protein molecule. Okay, so that region which starts from a start codon and stop codon is known as the ORF, open reading frame. Then deciphering the genetic code, decoding the genetic code. breaking the genetic code, identification of genetic code, which genetic codes for which amino acid. This important functions are, this important inventions are achieved by many scientists. They got Nobel Prize for their work. And they are Nirenberg and Mettei experiment, Hargobind Khurana experiment, and Nirenberg flip leader experiment and in vitro experiment. So these are the four experiments through which we came to know that this codon codes for this particular amino acids. Now we will see one by one these experiments. So first experiment is Nirenberg and Mettei experiment. He carried out the experiment in 1961. So he synthesized actually four polynucleotide. One polynucleotide contains uracil, one polynucleotide contains adenosine, one polynucleotide contains cytosine. He also synthesized one nucleotide with guanosine, but due to this stacking of the guanosine residue, self-piling of the guanosine residue, he is unable to utilize it for the synthesis of protein. So he used only three. One is U. So when he used all uracil containing ribonucleotide mRNA, he will get a protein with phenylalanine. When he used adenosine, he got lysine. When he used cytosine, he got protein. So he proposed that UUU codon codes for phenylalanine. AAA codes for lysine, CCC codes for proline. So after synthesizing this nucleotide, he utilized the extract from the E. coli. So the E. coli extract, which are responsible for the protein, is mixed with this polynucleotide, and they will synthesize protein and they will check the protein sequence, amino acid sequence in the protein. Okay, so if when they use uracil, they got phenylalanine. When they use adenine, they get lysine. When they use cytosine, they got proline. So they conclude that these three codons are deciphered. So Nirenberg and Mettei deciphered three codons: UUU, AAA, CCC. Okay. Then next experiment is carried out by Khurana in 1968. He actually identified only two codons. He synthesized an mRNA molecule with an alternate base ACACAC. So he synthesized a nucleotide which contains two bases, ACACACAC. So when he used such mRNA for the synthesis of protein, he get a protein with two amino acids, 309 histidine, 309 histidine. But he don't know whether ACA codes for 309 or whether ACA codes for histidine, or CAC codes for 309 or CAC codes for histidine. So to prove this, he again did one more experiment. He added two adenosine and one cytosine. So he synthesized an mRNA which contains two adenosine, one cytosine. So when he synthesized mRNA like that, there are three possibilities are planned. One is that AAC can code or ACA can code. If you leave this first residue, you will get ACE. If you leave two residue, you will get CAA. Then you may ask, if we remove three residue, what you will get? You will get AAC. Again, it's look like first choice. So they are not going for the fourth residue. Okay. So when they remove a first residue, they will get one particular polypeptide chain. When they remove the second residue, they will get another polypeptide chain. When without removing that, they will get one particular amino acid. So they came to know that by comparing this sequence, what is the possibility of sequence AAC, ACA, CAE? If you compare this ACA, CAC. So the amino acid which is present here, as well as the amino acid derived from here, which is similar, 309 is simple. So they conclude that ACA codes for 309. Once ACA codes for 309, then automatically the CAC codes for histidine. So again, Khurana identified two codons. One is ACA, the other one is CAC. He doesn't know whether the AAC codes for aspartine or CAA codes for glutamine. That he don't know that. But he concluded that ACA codes for 309 and CAC codes for histidine. So two codons again deciphered by this Khurana experiment. Then the final and a very important experiment of Nirenberg and Flippli that come to picture. They actually identified almost all the 61 codons. For that they will use nitrocellulose membrane. This nitrocellulose membrane actually used where they filtered the tRNA molecule as well as the trinucleotide as well as the ribosome. They did an experiment with all 64 codons. They synthesized all 64 codons in triplet. And they will also synthesize all the 32 tRNA molecules are required for translation. Then they will took 20 tubes. We know that 20 basic amino acids. So 20 tubes they took. Then they put all the nucleotides, triplets, 61 triplets, and the tRNA which contains all the 20 amino acids, that is in 32 tRNA molecules, which will recognize these 61 codons. But in that, only one amino acid is radiolabeled in one tube. So in 20 tubes, 20 different amino acids is radiolabeled. Okay. So they put all the 61 codons in one tube. They know that which amino acid is radiolabeled. Okay. That is they know. Okay. They know all the requirements, the machinery is required for the particular codon. So 20 tubes containing, each tube containing one amino acid is radiolabeled. So they will put, say for example, they will put triple U trinucleotide in all the test tubes. What they know? They know which amino acid is radiolabeled. So when they put the trinucleotide will bind to a particular tRNA molecule, amino acid attached tRNA molecule with the ribosome. So when they transfer that tube to this hydrocellulose paper, only those tRNA molecules are attached with the ribosome remains on the filter paper. The others will go out. In all the 20 tubes, in only one tube, the radioactivity amino acid is present on the nitrocellulose membrane. They know which amino acid is there. So in that, the amino acid will be a phenylalanine. It is labeled there. In all other radio-labeled amino acid is not deposited under ribosome. So that is how they conclude that triple U codes for that particular phenylalanine. Like that, they change next to triple nucleotide. Then they did for another. So like that, they did for all different 64 trinucleotides. They come to know that 61 codons codes for amino acid, 3 codons not code for any amino acid, and they are named as stop codons are nonsense codons. So this is how we identified all the 64 codons. Then we already put like in vitro experiment. The next experiment will be an in vitro experiment, that is the fourth experiment. What they did is, they don't know which is an initiation codon. So that initiation codon is actually identified by that particular in vitro experiment. In all the different E. coli mRNA molecules, the first codon is found to be AUG codon. And similarly, they also identified that when the translation is blocked, when the mRNA molecules will have one of this UAG or UGA codon, translation stop. So start and stop codons are determined by the in vitro experiment. So the four experiments, first experiment of Nirenberg and Mathai experiment, Corona experiment, Nirenberg and Leder experiment, as well as the in vitro experiment actually leads to the invention of the genetic code. Dictionaries derived with these experiments. So with these experiments actually, they determine the genetic code dictionary. This is what called as a genetic code dictionary, which comes out of that experiment. Before going to this genetic code dictionary, we should also think about the other terminology, that is about Vogel hypothesis. This hypothesis is actually proposed by Crick. This hypothesis actually explains how a single codon is recognized by more than one tRNA molecule. No, we told that tRNA will have particular trinucleotide, codon will have trinucleotide, so they will interact. How a single codon recognized by more than one tRNA molecule? So that is baffling question is answered by the hypothesis proposed by Crick, which is known as the Vogel hypothesis. Vogel means loose base pairing. That means what? Not all the tRNA molecule is going to have the Watson and Crick base pairing with the codons. By forming non-Watson and Crick base pair, by forming a weak base pairs, which is not a Watson and Crick base pair, the tRNA can recognize more than one codon. So for that they proposed different points. The first point is that the first two base of codon always form strong Watson and Crick base pair. So when a tRNA molecule recognizes a codon, so the mRNA is going to be in 5' to 3' direction. So tRNA will be 3' to 5' direction. So 3' first base of 3' tRNA. Okay. Then second base of 3-tRNA and first base of 5' end of codon, second base of 5' end of codon, that is mRNA, will form a quad centric base pair. That is the first one. Then where the loose base pairing occurs, this third base, the third base, if you see in 5' to 3' direction in an mRNA, the third base. Okay, similarly in 5' to 3' direction of tRNA, it's the first base. So the first base of tRNA, third base of mRNA is actually involved in the formation of oval base pairing. That too, not all the bases are going to involve in the oval base pair. For example, if the first base is going to be the A in the case of tRNA and U in the case of mRNA, they won't form an oval base pair. It's a normal Watson-Crick base pair. Similarly, if the first base is C, it won't form an oval base pair. So these two will form a normal base pair. But if the third base of tRNA is uracil, then it can bind with A or G. So A is a normal base pairing, but with G is considered to be as a oval base because G always pair with C, not with U. But here it recognizes. That's why it is known as a oval base pairing. Similarly, if the first base of tRNA is G, then it can oval base pair with U. But it usually pair with C, that is a normal Watson base pairing. But if it recognizes with G, U, it is called as an oval base pairing. Similarly, if the third base is a modified base, then it can bind off with all the three base pairs through a oval base pair. So, depending upon the first base of anticodon, you can say whether the base pairing is a oval or a normal Watson-Crick base pairing. So, when the first base of anticodon is U, that's what we saw here. Okay, when it is a U, it can form an oval base pairing. When the I are a modified base pair, it can also form a base pair. So that is how the third base is actually decides of an mRNA, and first base of tRNA will decide whether it will form a oval base pairing or a normal base pair. Then for a particular amino acids which differs, the codon which differs in the first two base pair, the codon which differs in the first two base pair requires a different tRNA model. But the amino acid which the codon or the tRNA which differs in the last or in the case of first of tRNA molecule can recognize same codon or different codon. But if you change any nucleotide in the first two base pair, it needs another tRNA molecule. There are about 13 tRNA molecules are required to code for 61 different codons. So this actually indicates that the oval base, if U is there, it can form three oval base pair. If C is there in the tRNA molecule, it can form two codons. If A is there, it can also identify two codons. If G is there, it can recognize two codons. Of this, one will be a oval, one will be a normal. If it is G, it is C is normal, U only oval. If it is A, U is normal, I only oval. If C is in the tRNA, then G is a normal base pair, I is an oval base pair. If U is present, then all the three will be like, if U is present, A is a normal, G and I considered to be as a oval echoes. So like this, in eukaryote also, almost we have the same type of repeats. But you can see this, A is present, there is no oval base pair. If G is present, there is no oval base pair. Only in U and C, you have possibility of oval base pair. So this is what the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So by identifying the codon which codes for particular amino acids, we can draw this particular genetic code dictionary. So you can easily remember the genetic code dictionary by remembering this four bases, U, C, A, G. U, C, all genes. So U, C, A, G can be remembered as U, C, all genes. So U, C, A, G, U, C, A, G, U, C, A, G. So first base will be here, U, U, Punnett square. I hope everybody remembers like Punnett square. So U, U. So first U is here, you can take. This is the second U, and third U is this. So U, U, U. What is second one? U, U, C. Third one, U, U, A. Fourth one, U, U, G. Like that, you fill up the nucleotides. That is what codons. Then you can see these amino acid code by this particular triplet codon. Okay, so this is known as genetic code dictionary. And this is that in some variations, in some organisms, some codons will code for different amino acids. That's what here is indicated. In some organism, it codes for arginine. Something it is called as a stop codon. That's what the none here indicates. Okay. In some case, CUG codes for leucine. Some organism it codes for serine. So that is what the changes are indicated in the genetic code. And this is also known as the codon preference table also. And this change in these amino acids can be identified through this phylogenetic tree. So as per the evolution, these type of changes are identified. Why? The different amino acid codes for different codons, it's all arise because of the evolution process. Okay, so this is how we can frame the genetic code dictionary by this experiment as well as this Hubble hypothesis logic. With this, the first unit of, that is first section of 5th unit of molecular biology paper is going to finish. If you have any question with this section, you can contact me through mail ID or through phone. sivabio@gmail.com or 9865-866-168. I will reply to your questions through mail or phone. And these are the books which are followed to explain this particular concept. With this, I conclude the first section of 5th unit of molecular biology paper. Thank you. Thank you very much.